Good morning, church. How we doing? Good? Let's begin our time. Hosanna. Last week at the end of the service, and Ray and I were actually just talking about a line in there. It says, if you tarry until you're better, you will never come at all. And that's something just to remember in your lives as we leave this place. You can't come to you can't clean yourself up and come to Jesus. You have to come and let him do that work. So it's part of what the song's about.
Jesus ready, saints to Good morning and welcome to Liberty. Whether in person or online, we're so glad you've joined us today. We have three ways that you can give your tithes and offerings here at Liberty. In person, the giving box on the back table, online, lbcspokane.com, or mail it directly to our office. And if you're a visitor with us today, we invite you to fill out a visitor's card and also drop that in the giving box on the back table. Life groups are now resuming. If you are not plugged into a life group yet, but would like to be, please let us know. You can either fill out a form in the back, or you can contact Tim Ray or Pastor Jim, and we can connect you with a life group for you. You can also find information about these groups on our bulletin or on our website. The monthly senior luncheon will take place Wednesday, November 9th. At the China Dragon on Queen Avenue. This will be at 11:30 in the morning. If you have any questions, please see Charlotte Zayas. Ladies, join us Friday evening, November 11th from 6:30 to 9 p.m. for our Women and Worship event. Tickets are $10 and you can purchase those today. This will provide an evening of women, worship, food, games, and prizes. Plan now to join us Sunday, November 13th for our Give Thanks Sunday. During this 11 o'clock hour, we will be enjoying worship and also a time where you can share your thankfulness to God. Immediately following that service, we will be enjoying a potluck downstairs. If your last name begins with A through M, please bring a main dish and a side. If your last name begins with N through Z, please bring a main dish and a dessert. And all are welcome to stay. Invite a friend for next week. Our mission spotlight this week is David and Hope Reinhardt, missionaries to Chile. The Reinhardts have seen many immigrants coming from South America, specifically to the area of Venezuela. Two churches have had to expand in order to accommodate these people. They have seen many souls saved, especially two Catholics that they had been praying for. Continue to pray for the Reinhardts, for their safety, and for the growth of their church. As we speak of missions and missionaries, we want to remind you to commit to giving to missions. If you received a missions giving card last week or today, this is just your personal reminder to continue giving to these missionaries as they spread the gospel of Jesus around the world. We're happy you chose to worship with us today here at Liberty. If we can be of any assistance to you, please call our office. We look forward to seeing you again next week, where our service times are Sunday school at 10 o'clock a.m. and then our worship service at 11 o'clock a.m. We pray today's service is a blessing and an encouragement to you.
Good morning, everyone. I don't know if you saw it. I sent out a text yesterday, and I don't know if you've seen them this morning, but we've got new gospel tracts. New cards so we can invite people to church, and I encourage you to grab a handful of those. You go through the coffee stand, or you got somebody that you'd like to invite to church, maybe at work or something else, and you'd never know how people respond if you just invite them. And you it's the old saying is 100% of the people come that you never invite, right? I mean, they don't come. So we need to invite people, and of course, you know, as the Lord leads you, I encourage you to be faithful with that, but there, you'll find those out on the table out front. As far as our prayer requests this morning, our brother Billy, it's good to see him. I don't mean to put him on the spot, but he's actually living with his brother Bob, and a car went through their house this week. And he's just showing me pictures, and praise God that both he and his brother are well, shaken up, but his brother had debris and the wall on top of him, and some drunk driver hit him. So praise the Lord. Thanks for sharing that with me, Billy. We need to be in prayer for one another. I mean, it's tough even living in your own house. Anyhow, so yeah, Lou and Mindy got broke into. They still have yet to get their door fixed, and it's not because they're not trying. It's just been backordered, right? So we're still, and pray that their house will sell. That'll happen. Kelps actually are under contract with their house. Praise the Lord. It's an answer to prayer for them. Been prayer for Gail Millward. I sent a text out about her this week. She had her breast cancer surgery. She's healing. She's at home doing well. Obviously didn't feel like being at church today. So just be in prayer for her continued healing. Said everything went well. Charlotte, you got an update on that? Everything went well, and she did just fine. So and continue to be in prayer for the Pippins. We love you guys, and I mean to keep bringing it up, but we love them, and we care about them. We care about their heart, their loss, and if you guys need anything at all, continue to be in prayer for the Pippin family. Christy Kelp's mother, you may have mentioned this, her mother has cancer, and so she's asking for prayer for her mother and her health. Continue to be in prayer for Pete. McDonald, his health, Jack Taylor, his continued health. We mentioned last week Rick Jacks wanted prayer for his neighbor's mother, Carol, with cancer. And Monica's mother also has cancer, so obviously that's very tough on her. Be in prayer for the midterm elections this week. And you say, how can we, you know, what are we supposed to do? Well, first off, you should vote and get registered to vote if you're not. And then we should pray for all of our politicians, whether you like them or not. We're commanded to. And you say, well, I don't want to pray for them. Well, too bad. You're supposed to. And you might just pray specifically, pray that they'd be saved, right? Pray that God would, that somebody would teach them to fear God. And that's praying for them. And you pray, you don't always have to pray that God would give long life or anything like that. But you do want to pray for one another. And we need to pray for our leaders, our elected officials. And by the way, I just remind you, as always, God is in charge of our country and our world. Amen? He is. But we got to do our part, that's part of voting and praying being responsible citizens. Be in prayer for the persecuted Christians. We mention them every week all around. It is illegal to be a Christian in North Korea. To own a Bible is really a death sentence or a prison sentence, just to own a Bible. And you need to be aware of that and pray. And there are literally over 100,000 Christians in North Korea. Many are underground, and you know, since they're underground, there might be a million. You just don't know. But they need our prayers. We need to be in prayer for one another. Life is not easy, right? You go to bed one night and the car busts right into your house, you know, and then next day you find out you got cancer. I mean, this is life, and it's not easy, but it is doable with the Lord. Amen. We're just saying at our life group the other night, I don't know how people do it without a family structure. And if you don't have any family, you've got a family here. You do. You have a family. Want to be your brother, want to be your sister. If you don't have a church family, you have also one here. These are good places to help you not only find accountability, but community. And we all need community. We are made for community. And people don't mean to, but they remove those things because we get busy. But I just want to remind you how important that is to you and to one another. And it was mentioned, the potluck. I'm going to make a promise that I'm going to preach a five-minute message next week. And again, I know you don't think it's possible, but come and check it out and see if it is. And the reason why is because I want to give room for everyone else to give thanks. And if there's not thanks, I'm going to open back my Bible and I'm going to, yeah, there's going to be a stopwatch. I don't care. You can gong me. I know exactly what I'm going to say. And and you say, well, I wish you already knew what you said and get it done with. Now, obviously, we all love the Lord and love the Word, but I want to hear from you. And, this is a wonderful opportunity. Grab some of these. Invite somebody to church. You pray this week, God, who can I invite to church next week? Because people need to hear about the Lord and about the gospel. Amen? He will change their life. He'll certainly change their eternal life. And you know people who don't know Christ. You know people who need to hear the life-changing words from the Word of God, and they need to be invited to church. Any other prayer requests this morning? Anybody got? Jet, you had something for your friend. Who was that? Annie. Got sickle cell anemia. So be in prayer for Jet's friend, Annie. We've prayed for her before. Anybody else? Yes. Is it John? Yeah, continue to be in prayer for Marvin's son, John. His health, his back. All right, anyone else? All right, it's good to have Mom here today with us. And it would be even nicer, she's leaving tomorrow. So, all right, let's pray. Okay. Lord, thank you for your love for us. And thank you that you love us just the way we are. And you love us too much to keep us that way. Lord, I thank you for our family. Thank you for the love that we share with one another. Thank you that Mom is able to be here. And Lord, we do pray for continued blessing on her life. My mom, continued safety. Lord, I do pray for the needs today, needs for our country. And Lord, we pray about them all the time. Remind us again that worrying about it or talking about it won't change anything, but our vote and our prayers matter the most. So, Lord, help us to sink these truths deep in our heart, that we serve the eternal God who is in control of everything. Lord, we don't understand it, and I don't attempt to try to explain what's going on with everything, but, Lord, you want us to trust you. So, Lord, you want us to trust you with our health. You want us to trust you with our finances. Lord, I do pray for Christy's mother, that you'd miraculously heal her cancer. Do the same with Jack. Lord, do the same with Gail Millward. Lord, do the same with Pete. Lord, we pray that you'd work miracles in all these lives, that there'd be no more hint of cancer. And Lord, that might not be your will, but we just pray that that would be accomplished. Lord, I pray that as we hear your word today, we'd be encouraged, would be challenged, and Lord, we'd go out of this place better servants of yours, living a holy life, because we know that that matters to you. Lord, we love you, and we thank you for the opportunity to be here today and love one another and support one another. I do pray, thank you for Billy, that he and his brother are safe. Thank you for that miracle. Thank you for Christy and Josh, their house selling, and Ray and Katie, being able to get so much accomplished on their new place. Lord, we thank you for all these blessings. Lord, we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. All the youngsters can be dismissed today. Why don't you open your Bibles, if you would, to Psalm 101. Psalm 101 is where we're at. And we were in Psalm 24 last week, and we talked about getting closer to God. 2 weeks ago, we talked about heaven, the reality of heaven, who's going to heaven, how do you get to heaven. Last week, we talked about getting closer to God, how you can get closer to God, how you can know that you are indeed following God and serving God. And I want to remind you, like I said last week, is that God never moves. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And when he says, draw nigh to God, he'll draw nigh to you. That simply means us taking a step toward him by obedience and fulfilling and obeying his word. And if you remember in Psalm 24, in fact, you can turn there just real quick, and you don't need to put it up on the screen, Brett, or nothing, but just a couple, just a reminder here in Psalm 24. Remember what he says, that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. You remember that? So, if you're going to get closer to God, you need to remember every day that everything belongs to God, right? I mean, everything. And that's your own body. That's your own soul. That's your own your time, talent, and treasure. Everything. We are not owners. We're just stewards. And not only that, is we need to ascend into his presence every day by giving our hearts, our time to him, and then really realizing through worship that God is in control of everything. That is really part of growing closer to God. And I'm going to elaborate a little bit more on that in Psalm 101 today. And I've just entitled this Practical Ways to Practice Holiness or Cultivating a Godly Life. I thought I'd start off this way today. Is your friends that are you're closest to, maybe have known you for some time, how would they describe you? Would they say that you're a funny man or woman? Would they say that you are generous? Would they say that you are forgiving? I mean, how would they describe you? I won't ask for you to say it out loud, but how would they describe you? Now, how would your family describe you? They know you best. Would they say you're generous? Would they say you're kind? Would they say that you are funny? You know, probably not as funny as you think you are. But, you know, how would they describe you? And would either one of those groups, and this just tells us the real story, would either one of those groups describe you as holy? Would your friends or your family describe you as holy? You say, well, goodness, I'm not even sure what holiness means. Only holy I know is holy moly. Truth is, I want to remind you, as many people say, I don't really know that I have any use for holiness. You better have and give some thought to holiness and care about holiness, because if you are a Christian, you will always, and mark this down, you will always struggle with fears, doubts, anxiety, have no confidence, and no power or desire to know God or overcome the enemy if you do not attempt to live the holy life. Holiness is what you are called to. You are called. Now, again, it was prayed. It was said this morning. Jeremy said it, is that God wants us to come to him and he'll clean us up. And that is exactly the truth. But the bottom line is we do have personal responsibility in the choices we make every day, whether or not we're living holy lives. And this is what we see David again. He said it in Psalm 23, the earth is the Lord's, the fullness of thereof, everything in it. And we need to align ourselves with that thought every day. By the way, this election process, God knows exactly what's going to happen. For positive or for negative, God knows. Little history about Psalm 101, obviously composed by David. And there's three different times that people or theologians say that this might have been written by David for these purposes. The first is when, upon the death of Saul, that's the first king, David began to reign in his stead in Hebron over Judah. Might have been written then. The second was when he began to reign, David began to reign in Jerusalem over all Israel and Judah. And then the third time, possibly, it was written by David when he brought the Ark of the Covenant to the house of Obed-Edom in the city of David. Now listen to these thoughts as introduction, just to kind of plant the seed in our mind that this psalm has been entitled The Godly Purposes and Resolves of the King, or A Mirror for Kings. Matthew Henry said about Psalm 101 that it's called the Householder's Psalm, because David gives rules which he laid down for his own household, his own kin, his own court, and all future kings to follow here in Psalm 101. Psalm 101 has been regarded by some, listen to this, as a portrait for an ideal ruler, a portrait for an ideal godly ruler. We see in Psalm 101 the actual address of David to God, making profession of his intentions and asking God to help him draw closer to him and live a holy life. There's really four words that are synonymous in the scriptures that you're probably, when I say this, going to be aware of it. But holiness is synonymous with separation. It's synonymous with sanctification. And it's synonymous with saint. Basically, all meaning the same thing. When you read the scriptures, they all mean pretty much the same thing. They mean set apart. Set apart for God's purposes. In fact, this, just a simple explanation, you probably heard it before, this podium is a holy, sanctified podium. Really, it's only used for one purpose, marrying, burying, and preaching. I don't, cut out little pieces and use it for wood projects. I don't go and use it as, if I'm at a ball game or football game, just to sit there. I don't use it for any other reason other than really to preach and teach the word. So it's a sanctified, by that definition, a holy piece of furniture used for just one purpose. And that's what he says that Christians, and that's what David in this Psalm 101 is wanting to be, a holy, sanctified, set apart for a particular purpose item. We see that in the Old Testament tabernacle, there were pieces of furniture. They were holy or sanctified only to be used by the priests and worshiping of God. That's the same with this church building. We use it for fellowship. We use it for some things, again, marrying and bearing, but largely it's for gospel purposes. It's a sanctified house. It's a set-apart house, not just for entertainment or just any reason, but for really biblical reasons. To expand a little bit, I need to, right before we jump into Psalm 101, talk about what holiness is and the two parts of it. There's positional separation or holiness. And the scripture here is, Paul says to the Corinthians, he says, "Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God?" He says, don't be deceived or uninformed, neither fornicators or idolaters or adulterers or effeminate or abusers themselves with mankind or thieves or covetous or drunkards or revilers or extortioners shall not inherit or shall inherit the kingdom of God. He says these group of folks won't inherit the kingdom of God. And then he says in verse 11, he says, but such were some of you, past tense, such were some of you. You say, well, man, I still do these sometimes. Well, listen, if you are saved, you are separated positionally. You have become positionally holy. You've become a child of God. Whether or not you feel holy, you positionally are a child of God. And that's what we call, according to the Bible, positional separation. And he says, such were some of you, but now you are what? Sanctified. So you have been sanctified. And again, that's synonymous with holy. You have now, because of the blood of Christ, not because of your works and not because you're a good person, but you are sanctified and set apart for God. Now, how good of a Christian is totally up to you. Amen? How worthy and how, none of us are worthy, but how effective of a Christian is totally up to you in how you live your life. Now, so that's positional separation. If you're saved today, you positionally, you have a position in the family of God. You are a son and daughter of Christ. If you're saved, say amen today. Amen. Amen. You are positionally sealed and sanctified. You are positionally holy. But now, every day of your life, you have choices, faith choices, to either live a holy life, a separated life, a sanctified life, or not. And so this is kind of where we go with Psalm 101. But one more verse with this. As a Christian, I'm to live a set-apart life for God. The scripture here is, as obedient children, go to that next one there, as obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former lusts in your ignorance, but as he which called you is holy, so be holy in all manner of conduct or conversation. So, wait a minute, you already said we're holy. Well, again, that's positional. Now, this is practical. Practically, you have choices to make every day of your life, whether you are going to indeed live a holy, sanctified life like he is holy. That's what the scripture says. So my question is, first off, how are you doing with that? How are you doing with holiness? I already told you that if you have no use for holiness, you will find no place for satisfaction. You'll find no place for confidence in your faith. I'm not taking away your salvation, but you will not ever really be content and happy and win the struggle over the flesh and fear and anxiety and forgiveness and unforgiveness and bitterness. You'll never win those battles about God's plan for your future until you practice holiness, until you intentionally try. You're never going to succeed 100%, but until you intentionally try to live a holy life. Somebody say amen. Now, this is a tough distinction because I'm certainly not saying you're saved by your works, but I am saying you're sanctified by your works. You're set apart by how you live your life. And if you do not intentionally follow God and remove fear, take the shield of faith daily, you're going to be overwhelmed by this old dark world. And this is where he goes. So now, we said that it's this Psalm 101 is a portrait. So what's a portrait of a king? What's he look like? Well, I mean, you know, I don't know. You can just, but this is spiritually the portrait, what we're going to read here. We'll go through it quickly. The portrait of what a king is. So if it's good for a king to live holy, godly this way, it's certainly good for the common Christian like you and I. Amen. But we are royalty because of Christ. I'll remind you. We're joint heirs with Jesus. So he starts off with here about our song, a song of praise. Or in other words, I just entitled it, if you're going to live a holy life, you're going to have to watch your words, watch your mouth, shut your lips. Not everything you think should be said, because it can defile you. It can hurt you. It can ruin relationships and certainly limit your testimony. He starts off, Psalm 101:1, I will sing of mercy and judgment. Unto thee, O Lord, will I sing. Problem is we let anxiety, worry, the economy, the midterm elections, whatever it is in our life, we allow the things of this world to take away our song. Be careful that you don't allow your flesh to take over in fear, and the song you used to have of praise to God, it's gotten quiet. It's grown cold. Your words matter to God. He says, I will sing of mercy and judgment. Mercy just simply means forgiveness and withholding judgment. So David, in his first statement, he's saying, I want to praise God that he has shown mercy to me. He has shown forgiveness, and he has withheld his judgment from me. Aren't you thankful that God doesn't give us exactly what we deserve? Amen? He is showing mercy to you. And so if you're saved at all, that is God's mercy. It's the blood of Christ. That's his mercy. And judgment just simply means, by my estimation, he's withholding his judgment. You praise him. So what David is choosing, I'm choosing to praise versus choosing to stress. I'm choosing to praise versus choosing to worry. I'm choosing to praise instead of choosing to be mad or mean or angry. My song of praise is directed to the Lord, and it will include his mercy, thankfulness, and escape from his judgment. Basically, in essence, what David is trying to say, we need to choose our words wisely and be careful what we do with our words. Think about it. You didn't know I was going to speak about this at first, but are you choosy with what you say? Or do you just say exactly what comes to your mind? If you are one of those people that say exactly what comes to your mind, you are not deemed by most, whether you realize it or not, as a wise person. And many, even though they won't tell you, and they may love you to death, but you're probably looked at as a fool because you never control your mouth. Scripture says that James. He says, true religion undefiled before the Father is this, to visit the widows in her affliction, the fatherless, keep himself unspotted from the world. And he says, if any man offends in his tongue, or not in his tongue, same as a perfect man, but whoever offends with his tongue deceives himself and is a fool. Scripture is very clear on that. But we have choices to make every day. You say, well, I've got strong opinions. Funny thing is, not everybody cares to hear your strong opinions. And I'm not trying to jump too hard down your case. What I'm trying to say is, if you are going to be holy, you're going to have to control, like James 3 says, this little member that causes a great fire, he says. He says, with this, you remember in James 3, we won't go there, says, with this little member, on a Sunday morning, we praise God. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. We go out of these doors and we curse our brother. He says, these things, out of the same mouth comes bitter and sweet. He says, these things ought not so to be. It's what James says, half-brother Jesus. He says, if you're going to be a godly Christian, you've got to learn to close this. And that really starts with, like David's telling us, to praise. If you will praise and learn that principle, you're not going to curse others near as much. And you will watch your lips. Scripture says, Ephesians 4:29, let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth. What's corrupt communication? It might be broken words, meaning you're trying to break people apart, hurt people. It might be hurtful words. It might be dirty words, dirty jokes, callous words. Might be disrespectful, tearing down people with your words. You never do anything. You always do this, or you look this way, or you're ugly, you're fat, you're stupid, you're dumb. On and on, these words hurt. Callous words, misplaced words, angry words, even curse words. I'm surprised. So many people like to just throw them out and sometimes even use the name of God in vain, but they don't even realize that they're cursing all the time. He says, let no corrupt communication or words proceed out of your mouth, but that which is what? Good. Only let good words come out of your mouth. That doesn't mean, again, like we said last week, it doesn't mean every word that you're going to say, sometimes you've got to speak the truth in love. Those are still good words. You got to speak the truth many times. I'm speaking truth even if it hurts today. but it's how you bring it across. He says, but that which is good, why? To the use of edifying, building up, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. The big reason you have a mouth is to praise God and tell other people about God and to build others up instead of tear them down. If you can't control your own tongue, Bible says you deceive yourself and your religion is in vain. That's what he says. James says that. Colossians 4:6, let your speech be always. I'll say this about myself, and it's not to pat myself. People say, you're not talking a lot. You don't have a lot to say. It's because I'm biting my tongue. Amen? And I'm not, again, trying to pat myself in the back. Is that I've learned if I don't have anything good to say in a community or in a church or with family, I'm going to shut my mouth. And when I don't, man, I get in trouble. Amen? I mess up things. But be very careful. This is what he's starting off with. The portrait of a godly, growing Christian or king is somebody who praises God and they watch the mouth. Let your speech be always with grace. Gracious. What do gracious words do? Hey, you're enough. You're going to make it. I'm sorry you're going through this. God is at work even though you don't see him or feel him. These are gracious words. Sometimes the best words to say is just being there as a person, as a friend. Let your speech be always with grace. Right now, you came in here again, didn't know you're going to get a message about at first your tongue. Are your words gracious? Would your friends and your family consider you to be holy? The closest people to you, are you gracious with your mouth? Only you can change that. He says, let it be with grace so that you may know how you ought to answer every man. One more, and we'll move to the next one, Ecclesiastes 10. Surely the serpent will bite without enchantment. In other words, you can just walk by a serpent, he sees you, and he's gonna bite you. He says, a babbler, somebody with their mouth, is no better. The words of a wise man's mouth are gracious. Want to be wise? Have gracious words, kind words, generous words. Loving words, but the lips of a fool will swallow himself up. Many people say, I don't know why people don't like me. Shut your mouth and people might like you. I mean, Proverbs says that even a fool is known to be wise when he holds his lips, right? Again, yeah, I think we all understand. Be quiet. Shut your mouth. Quit talking. Stop. You can't be holy and godly by tearing people down and everything down. You just can't. The words of a wise man's mouth are gracious, but the lips of a fool swallow himself up. The beginning of the words of his mouth are in foolishness, and the end of his talk is mischievous. A fool is also full of words. A man cannot tell what shall be and what shall be after him. Who can tell him? Who can tell him? In other words, you can't tell a fool anything. So David says, the godly king. Remember, he wrote this for himself and he wrote this for would-be kings. They praise God and they watch their lips. They continually praise God. Are you doing well with that? If you are stewing too much about life and your situation by comparing your time in praising God, you're not living the holy, sanctified life. Your heart is filled with worry and anxiety and not with praise. That's what he's saying. Number two, we need to watch our path. Watch your words, watch your path. Or in other words, my steps. He says it right here, Psalm 101:2 in our text. I will behave myself wisely in a perfect way. Perfect means steady, whole, complete, mature, a single-hearted path. He says, I'll behave myself. Again, that's another good question, isn't it? How are you behaving yourself? Now listen, we're not talking about, you were saved by, praise God, and we're kept by him. Aren't you thankful we're not kept by our works? Amen. And what? Why do you keep preaching to us, Pastor, about holiness all the time? Because my goal is to make you an effective disciple of Christ. And by my estimation, the most effective disciple of Christ hears God's word and they become holy, sanctified. not better than anybody else and looking down their nose and say, no, you've not arrived. Look at me. No, that's pride and that's not holy. It's a gracious, loving, forgiven child of God. He says, I'll behave myself wisely in a perfect way. Oh, when will thou come unto me? I will walk within my house with a perfect heart. So he says, I'll behave myself. So he's talking about your path, your actions, what you do with your life. And don't miss what he says here. I will walk within my house with a perfect heart. If you can't walk in your own house in a godly way by what you do, and I'm not trying to say, no, this is sin, don't do this. You know whether it's sin or not by your own heart and the Holy Spirit speaking to you if you're a child of God. If you can do it in your house, if you're not living a godly life in your own house, you're certainly not going to live it outside of the house. But if you are doing work spiritually in the inside of a man or a woman when you're all alone, you're going to have a lot better victory when you're with others. I said it and it's true, in prayer breakfast a couple weeks ago, is that I've heard it for years, and it's true, just to remind you, is that there's really two battles to fight every day. There's the outside battle, and there's the inside battle. And the outside battle is against everything else, and even our own flesh, but the inside battle is our heart, and we need to fight every day to stay. And, of course, we've got Almighty God, His power, His Spirit. But He says, I'll behave myself. I will watch my steps. I'll watch my actions because I know that they matter. I wanted to show you some similarities. It's been some time since I showed these. These are to the Old Testament kings, to Judah and to Israel. And there's actually about 20 of them, and there's quite a few lists here, but I'm not going to read them all. Just you'll see something very similar. Right here it says, and Asa, look underlined there, did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord. And Jehoash did that which was right in the sight of the Lord all his days. And Amaziah, king of Judah, did that which was right in the sight of the Lord. Azariah, king of Judah, did that which was right in the sight of the Lord. Jotham, king of Judah, did that which was right in the sight of the Lord. Hezekiah did that which was right in the sight of the Lord. Josiah, Joash, Jotham did that which was right in the sight of the Lord. Hezekiah, king of Jerusalem, did that which was right in the sight of the Lord. Josiah, he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord and walked in the ways of David his father. We see some similarities here, and none of them were perfect. Many of them did halfway decent, these kings in Judah and in Israel. They did that which was right in the sight. What does that mean? They obeyed God and they obeyed his word. And so at the end of the day, or at the end of their rulership, God says, I approved of how you lived your life and walked with me. So we know that there are things that, by definition here, by these verses here, that are right in the sight of God, and there are some things that are not right in the sight of God. How you live your life, how you run your family, how you talk, how you walk, the decisions that you make, they're either right with God or not. And then we go on one more, 2 Kings 16:2, 20 years old was Ahaz when he began to reign. And he reigned 16 years in Jerusalem and did not that which was right in the sight of the Lord. One more chart here. I didn't want to take the time, but just verses here in Bible program. The children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord. They did it again. They continue to do it. This is the book of Judges. Solomon did evil in the sight of the Lord. Judah did evil in the sight of the Lord. We see Ahab did evil in the sight of the Lord. And so on and so forth. Listen. There is a distinction in the Bible, and certainly in Christianity, that there are things that displease the Lord, and there are things that please the Lord. And you say, well, give us a list. Here's your list. Amen? Here's your list. And we talked about last week, again, how you can get closer to God. Again, there's many different things. You just get a little bit of light, and as you read the Word, you study the Word, and you see these things, listen, you let it change you. Right here today, we're talking Psalm 101. Watch your words. Watch your actions. You cannot be pleasing to the Lord. Now, you are positionally, right? You are a child of God on your way to heaven, positionally, if you're saved. But now you have a choice every day by the Holy Spirit's power, by the power of fellowship, the Word, and the Holy Spirit to live the sanctified life. And the next one here is not just watch your words, your actions, but watch your steps. This is my sight, or my what I view, what I contemplate. This is back to our text, Psalm 101:3. David says, I will set no wicked thing before my eyes. I hate the work of them that turn aside. It will not cleave to me. Mine eyes shall be upon the faithful of the land. He that walks in a perfect way, he shall serve me. So David's saying that the king must put blinders on his eyes, and there are some things that are not appropriate for a child of God to view. It's kind of telling is that, you know, David wanted to build the temple for the Lord, but God said, no, you cannot build my temple, Solomon will, because you've been a man of war. In other words, what he meant is you've seen too much violence. You've been filled with violence. You've taken too many lives. You cannot build my house. So Solomon got to build his house. In other words, he let, probably no choice, but he let too much into his life and into his mind, and it certainly can take away some, no doubt, innocence, but some fellowship. But what we see here, what is he talking about? Wicked things. It may be of sexual nature, maybe in violence of nature. It may be horror in nature. Whatever it is it godly? Put it in your life. If it's not godly, and if it's not building up the soul and drawing you closer to God, as a child of God, you need to be wise enough to remove it out of your mind. How do you know when it is evil? Something about evil, no matter what form it comes in, it's tough to get those things out of your mind. Anybody understand what I'm saying? It doesn't have to be sexual, but it could be violent, it could be whatever. It's tough to remove those things. Seems like the good, you got to keep feeding and get it back in there and get it more in there, more in there. But the evil, you might have seen it once or twice and you can't remove it. You remember something from 10 years of age. Well, he says, listen, you're going to have to stay true to the Lord and watch what you look at. Listen, as you get older, I've told our own kids that way. We've had things on their phone, keep them, but there comes a certain point. There's none of our kids that we actually keep track of unless they want us to. We're trusting them, and so you've got to fight that battle. Every one of us, and to the boys, you got to fight that battle every day of your life. You got to choose to be holy. That's the truth, isn't it? We're free to make our own choices, but we're not free from the choices we make. Be very careful what you allow. I'll set no wicked thing before my eyes, is what he says. Important verse here, 2 Corinthians 10:4, says the weapons of our warfare are not carnal or fleshly or something you can hold on to, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Strongholds are citadels, bunkers, forts created by the enemy, by Satan, by demonic forces. And God wants those strongholds to be taken down, and we are many times, certainly in our flesh, helpless to take them down. And what are some of those? Again, they might be fear, might be worry, might be anxiety, might be guilt, might be lust, might be greed, whatever it may be. You have, Scripture says, we have strongholds. But he says, in order to help with those strongholds, he says, casting down imaginations, thoughts, reasonings, fears, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Listen to here. And bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. You say, how am I supposed to live my life? There's too much garbage. He says, it may sound daunting, but he says right here, if you're going to overcome strongholds, overcome the flesh, and be effective in this area of what you view, whatever form that may take, he says, you've got to bring into captivity. You've got to hold captive every thought and bring it to the obedience of Christ. Lord, is this okay with you? You take the word and say, God, is this okay? Is this pleasing to you? Does this glorify you? Is this all right with you? And if you see that it's not, throw it in the stronghold pile and throw it away and say, no, this is not growing me closer to the Lord. It's drawing me further away. And you would have to put your own fear, your own anxiety, your own guilt into that category, whatever that may be. He says, taking every thought captive. I'd ask you a question, Christian. How are you doing with that? Are you fighting that battle? Or have you given up long ago saying that, it's useless. There's no winning this battle. Listen, there is. With Christ, I can do all things. Amen? Whatever that may be. So we're talking about the holy life. D.L. Moody says, a holy life makes the deepest impressions. Lighthouses blow no horns, they just shine. C.S. Lewis said, how little people know who think, they think that holiness is dull. When one meets the real thing, it's irresistible. The last one, we close with this. He's talked about our words. The king, David says, as a king, as a child of God, as a king over Israel, I want to watch my words. I want to watch my steps. I want to watch my sight, what I view. This is a biggie. And this is not a judgment here, but this is what he says. I want to watch my companions. I want to watch who I'm around. As Abraham Lincoln said, show me your friends, I'll show you your future. You've got to be careful who. It doesn't matter whether you're an adult or an adolescent, it's important you're around good people. Unfortunately, we've got to be around all different kinds of people, right? Whether they're good or not, whether they're holy or not. Because if we're going to help people and love people, we've got to be around people. But listen, make sure you're a quality people. Make sure you're a godly people. Amen? Make sure that you are something, when you stand before God like these kings, everybody else might have an opinion, but God's opinion, yes, you're one of his children, no doubt, that's unnegotiable. But you did that which was right in the sight of God. See, that's what matters the most. Amen? You did. And it doesn't matter what anybody else is doing. You did what was right in the sight of God. Or you didn't do what was right in the sight of God. Scripture says we're going to give an account for even the idle words. Thank God we're not judged, but we're rewarded by those things. We're not lost or lose our salvation because of those, because we're saved by the grace of God. Watch your companions, the last thing. I'll try to get through this quickly. Separate from wicked people. Raise your hand if you know there's wicked people around. All right, there's wicked people. They want to do wicked things. Psalm 101:4 says, a froward heart shall depart from me. This is our text. Froward means difficult, disobedient, hard to deal with. He says, a froward person or a froward heart, I don't want it around me. Again, by definition, a difficult, disobedient, hard to deal with. Are you a difficult, disobedient, hard to deal with person? Listen, I don't want that for my children. I don't want that for me. I want people to sense the presence of God when they're around me. But that is not going to happen by accident. It's not going to happen if you don't keep your mind together, your heart together, your words together, your life together. If you're not a faithful person, a froward heart shall depart from me. I will not know, he says, a wicked person, a twisted person, a person who is not following God. I will, he says, destroy all the wicked of the land. I'll cut off the wicked doers. In other words, I will say to you, don't kill wicked, the wicked, okay? Don't kill them. But avoid them, is what he's saying. Don't be around them. You don't have to be a part of their wicked. Remember, wicked means to be twisted, twisted from God's word. Be careful of the people you associate with. We see in Psalm 1, we know it very well, blessed is the man, or you'll be blessed if you walk not in the counsel of the ungodly, or stand with sinners, or sit in those who are scorning all the time. Be careful who you keep company with. 1 Corinthians 5:11 says not to keep even with company with a Christian who is backslidden. Look what he says, but now I've written unto you, not keep company with a man who is a, or that's called a brother. So a Christian brother who is a fornicator, lives in known sin, a covetous, idolater, railer, drunkard, extortioner, don't even eat with him. For what I have to do with to judge without, do you not judge them that are within? But them that are without, God judge. Therefore, put away from you among that wicked person. You say, man, I got to be around that person in order to help him. I agree. But more often than not, we become part of those wicked deeds. And that's what we see the king saying. If you're going to be a child of God, you've got to be around good people, mostly. If you're around wicked people, yes, we need to be around people who are out of the way, backslidden people, unsaved people. No doubt, the lost people, in order to save them and influence them, even the backslidden, in order to make a difference. But listen, be very careful that they're not affecting you for wickedness or for ill. Amen? I think many times we like to look at these, oh, that's what the teens struggle with. That's what the young kids struggle with. My dealings mostly with adults, and this is what they struggle with. I mean, it is. They're companions and who they are around with. Usually, a couple has, they get married first year or two of marriage, and they struggle because of jealousies. You know, she doesn't want him to be around his friends that he's always had, and he didn't want her to be around these guys who are always checking her out and just on and on and on. And these are some good reasons, and it creates a lot of friction in the marriage. Why? Because many times neither one have lived a decent life up to this point. And so they don't necessarily trust one another completely. But then the people that they're around really are not of the greatest caliber. So you've got reason to doubt. What are you trying to say? What I'm trying to say is you've got to be very careful who you are around and who you allow people that you love to be around. But listen, this is important that we really catch this. 1 Corinthians 15:33, be not deceived. Evil companions will corrupt good morals. Three last verses here. Separation from, you know, some people. Our companions. Separation from slanderers and prideful people. Back to our text, Psalm 101:5. Whoso privately slanders his neighbor. This is David saying, the king. Him will I cut off, or in other words, I'll remove him out of my life. If somebody constantly slanders people I know and I love in front of me, they're not going to be a part of my life. Why? Well, check this out. If they'll slander people you know and love, that they say they know and love, when you're around, they're probably slandering you when to other people. I'm not trying to put doubts in mind. I'm just saying, don't be a slanderer. Don't be a scorner. Don't be somebody who's always looking down and picking apart everybody else, because you're going to put a question in people's mind, and rightly so. Whoso privately slanders his neighbor, him will I cut off. Him that has a high look and a proud heart, I will not suffer. In other words, I will not be around that person, somebody who's prideful. Do you see what he's saying in context? Listen, watch your words, praise God. Watch your thoughts. Watch your actions. Watch your acquaintances. And this is not being legalistic at all. These are not legalistic things. If you want to be holy, you got to do work in this area. Amen. People have missed holiness and missed a walk with the Lord because they've not called these things important. And that's just the matter of the fact. And then it doesn't mean they don't know God. They certainly do. But they're kind of playing church and going through it. This takes work. This builds spiritual muscle. But if you do not build this spiritual muscle, you're going to be lagging behind. Separation from the deceitful. My eyes shall be upon the faithful of the land. Not the liars, but the faithful. That they may dwell with me. And he that walks with a perfect way, he shall serve with me. He shall serve me. The last one, separation from close partnerships. We know this. If you've been a Christian many times, you've probably heard this, young man. And even when you're dating, you heard this. And it's still true. 2 Corinthians 6:14, be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship has righteousness with unrighteousness? What communion has light with darkness? In other words, this bears the most in a business or in a marriage. Don't marry somebody who does not know Christ. Now, it doesn't mean you can't have a future. You need to make sure they come to know Christ. But the bottom line is it's hard to turn on a love for God when it's not there and their heart's never been changed. Or to have, in a business, biblical morals and principles and ethics that you want to run a business by. Some people have it naturally, most don't. But when you run things according to the Word of God in a marriage, according to the Word of God, when you're both Christians, there is an agreement. But if you are not both Christians, there is not an agreement, and it makes it hard. And honestly, it's not, it doesn't have to be that way. It just doesn't, because we don't have to enter into that. Now, again, that's not to say anything negative against somebody who's unsaved or even somebody who's backslidden. What it means is David saying, listen, I've got to choose my friends, my words, my thoughts, all of these wisely. Does all this make sense? Amen. He says, listen, if you want to run harder after God than you have, be like the king and do these things. I sent this to my family this morning. Wasn't necessarily going to say that, but I think I've sent it to them before. Because I wouldn't mind if they made these resolutions every day, and I certainly wouldn't mind if you made these resolutions every day, because I think it's good. Close with this little, just I'll read it here, that at the age of 19, these resolutions were adopted by a man named James Clement Furman, later Dr. James Clement Furman, who became the first president of Furman University. And this is what he did from the age of 19 on. Certainly knew God, knew Christ, was filled with the Spirit, was born again, but he wanted to live a holy life. And he says, I'm resolved, 19-year-old, never to speak ill of an individual, but to call to mind my own sins and imperfections and be silent. Resolved, when my heart feels cold and languid, to strive earnestly in prayer to God for deliverance. Raise your hand if you ever, your heart ever feels cold and languid and stale, all right? He says, when my heart feels cold and languid, I will strive earnestly in prayer to God for deliverance from such a state and for the abiding influence of the Holy Spirit, and to inquire into the causes which have produced this effect upon me and guard against them in the future. It's a good resolution. Resolved never to go to bed without having endeavored to learn something more of God he's revealed in his holy scriptures than I knew when I rose in the morning. I know I say it often, and I want to remind it is, listen, this world, this old world does not have the answers. And the more you fill your life and mind with the garbage of everything and all the pressures and anxieties of this world, it is filling you with worry and anxiety and distrust. What I'm telling you is you're going to have to know what's going on in the world and vote and be a positive part of influence. But fill your mind with this. Fill your mind with truth. Fill your mind with God's word. Fill your mind with God's people. Amen? And good fellowships. And there's a way this stuff just doesn't have its effect on you. All the other stuff. Resolve to keep in mind during the business of the day the good resolutions which I've formed for my assistants, so that if I neglect them, I may humble myself and be in retirement, earnestly seek pardon of God. Resolve to say nothing to irritate the feelings of anyone, and especially of my relations and friends. Resolve to leave as soon as possible any company which might draw off my thoughts from the things of eternity. Resolve to never to neglect to devote a certain portion of every 24 hours to secret meditation and prayer. Resolve never to halt in doing anything of which I'm convinced that is my duty before God. Why don't you bow your heads and get alone with the Lord? Let me ask you, friend, are you a Christian? Have you been born again? Listen, don't put off that decision any longer. Are you a child of God? Are you a born-again Christian? You don't know how to become one? Listen, love to show you. Love to open the Word of God. Love to make sure you know that you're saved. If you are saved, just another simple list that we see from David here. We watch our words. How are you doing with that? We watch our thoughts. How are you doing with that? We watch our actions. How are you doing with that? We watch our acquaintances if we want to be holy. We're going to watch who we're around. You're going to be careful who you keep company with. How are you doing with those things? If you say, well, listen, I'm falling here, all you got to do is God's bar of soap. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Are you willing to get that right with the Lord? Might be back to the first. Watch your mouth. You willing to give that sin to the Lord? You willing to give that thing to the Lord? Whatever your need is. Just talk to the Lord. Tell him you're sorry. Tell the Lord, Lord, help me do better. Help me to stay in line with you. Help me to get in your word. Help me to pray. Help Help me to be around other Christians. Help me to confess my sins quickly. Help me to run from sin, whatever that may be. Father, thank you so much again for your word. Thank you for my friends. Lord, every time we open your word, it challenges us, it encourages us, and it builds our faith. Lord, help us to be and doing those things that are pleasing in your sight. Lord, we are pleasing because of the blood of Jesus Christ. It's undisputable. But Lord, we know from your word that there are things that draw us closer to you and that you approve of. And there are some things that certainly draw us away from a close walk with you. And Lord, help us to remove those as God-fearing Christians out of our life. Lord, we need your strength. We need your wisdom. We need your discernment. Lord, I pray that you'd continue to speak these words of truth to us this week. In Jesus' name, amen.
Today and for this time, we pray for those that are home that couldn't make it, that you would heal them, and pray, Lord, that we would just let you meet us where we are, and we'd walk away with this knowledge. And God's people said, amen. You are dismissed.